Good morning to everyone and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I remind everyone present to turn off electrical devices that may interfere with the sound system. The first item on the agenda is item one, which is for the committee to take items three and four in private. Are we all agreed to take items three and four in private?
Yes.
Thank you. Before we start, today we have two panels of witnesses, and before we start with our first panel, I would just like to ask if there are any declarations of interest from committee members. John Mason.
Yeah, I would just declare, I noticed one of the witnesses later on is on the ICAS ethics board, and I've also been on that board until recently.
Thank you. Bill Bowman.
I'm a member of ICAS, and there are witnesses giving evidence, and Professor Paisey trained when I was a partner in KPMG in Aberdeen, as did her husband, who's also mentioned, Nick Paisey, on the document.
Right, thank you. Dean Lockhart.
Yes, I am a member of the Law Society of England and Wales.
Although I'm not a member of the Law Society, I suppose I should declare that I'm still a practicing advocate and member of the Faculty of Advocates. Sorry, Jackie Bailey.
Convener, whilst we're in the mood for declarations, I suppose I should declare I'm a member of UNISON.
Right. Any other declarations at this stage of possible interests? No. Well, thank you very much. We'll then move on to our first set of witnesses, and I'll introduce them in no particular order. First of all, Peter Hunter, who is Regional Manager of UNISON Scotland. Welcome. Cheryl Gedling, who is the Industrial Officer, Public and Commercial Services Union, or PCS. Good morning. Anne Henderson, who is the Assistant Secretary of the STUC. Good morning. And also welcome to Richard Hardy, who is the National Secretary of Prospect. May I ask members to keep their questions succinct, and also if witnesses could try to do so with their answers. And if there are areas that are covered today in the session and witnesses wish to submit written information in response to that after the session, then the committee would welcome that. Now, I would like to start, first of all, with a question for our first panel of witnesses, and this is about the statistics that are available in Scotland on pay, earnings, and employment for men and women. And I would like to ask the panel members if they are confident that we have a definitive set of statistics, or in what way these statistics we have could be improved upon. And in asking the question, I noticed that the UNISON submission to the committee at page 3, and I think paragraph 2 of the submission, referred to this issue, and the comment was made that Scottish participants in a particular type of data issue were frequently unable to fully answer questions due to the absence of disaggregated data, and also comment about the Scottish Government commitment to fair work and inclusive growth, but a need to for data to reveal impact. So perhaps we could start first with Cheryl Gerling, if you would like to expand upon the point, and then the other witnesses could come in to give comment.
I could, but I'm not from UNISON. I wonder if the
well,
UNISON
that is my mistake entirely, and I do apologise for suggesting that it was yourself.
For Cheryl to fill in the gaps.
And yes, it's coming back from the Easter break is my excuse, so my apologies again. And Peter Hunter, I think, is the
Thank
correct
you.
Person to ask
the,
that question of.
My background, I used to work at the low pay unit, so we used to do regular data analysis, and it was a common experience if we were looking, for example, to break down earnings data by gender and working time. By the time we were getting to the regions of Scotland, very frequently there were gaps in the tables because the sample size wouldn't support the analysis we wanted to do. So that's been a long-standing problem. My submission makes reference to the Scottish Government contribution to the overall UK report to the review of our compliance with the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, which took place last year. and the periodic review for all human rights compliance is ongoing at the moment, and it was an accepted observation on all parties that the data did not disaggregate well for Scotland, that UK data was reasonably robust, but that by the time you reduced the sample size down to Scotland, we weren't able to comment on a variety of economic and social indicators that the UN wanted to hear about. So we do have a data problem, and I see from previous discussions that people who are better qualified to talk about that than myself, academics have talked about that and other interest groups. So that's something that's, I think, is would be an important finding from the committee, that you do need to have the data to be sure that whatever policies are adopted are having the desired impact.
Right, thank you. Anne Henderson, I think, wants to come in at this point.
I would endorse that from the STUC's point of view, and I know that Scottish Government, in discussion with the STUC and some of the labour market work that's being done at that level, have shared that concern. I think some of the changes that are taking place in the labour market, and reference has been made to those as well in earlier discussions around increased self-employment. What does that actually tell us? Is it masking underemployment? Is it like, what does that tell us? Some of the detail we really don't have. I think some of that's a UK-wide problem, the trend towards precarious work. We use the language, but we don't know what it actually means for people's day-to-day lives and their jobs. We don't know necessarily the sectors it's concentrated most in Scotland, and it makes it very difficult to then target interventions in the labour market. And the latest labour market figures with the showing the increase around economic inactivity without us really knowing what that is also very important.
Thank you. Richard Hardy, I don't know if you wish to comment on this.
Well, obviously to back up both of my colleagues on the right have said, but also to indicate that where pay reporting is done, it's quite important that it isn't just a mean or median across a whole organisation, that without digging down into pay grades and jobs of equal value, you don't get the sort of information that you need to resolve an equal pay issue. If you take a too broad a view, the data is largely meaningless.
Thank you. And perhaps at this stage, Cheryl Gedling.
Thank you. Yeah, I think from a civil service sort of specific perspective, I think the point that Richard's made there is really significant. The civil service is different to the rest of the public sector, and having a story to tell about the consequence of pay delegation, 20 years pay delegation, so there are no UK-wide or Scotland-wide pay rates. These are devolved down to departmental level. So I could be working in one department earning £2,000 less or more than someone doing a job at the same grade in another department. And I think until we recognise that's an issue that has to be addressed, and of course I'll raise the issue about pay restraints and the impact of pay restraint, which we will no doubt come on to talk about more in this session. Until we recognise that's an issue that has to be resolved, then any data that you have will not be an accurate reflection of what's happening across the civil service and the rest of the public sector.
I think Peter Hunter wanted to come back in.
Just to something positive in addition to the critical observations that have been made. The devolution of tax powers, the increasing devolution of tax powers to Scotland fits in with data collection. The annual survey of hours and earnings gathers data through HMRC returns on an annual basis. It's a massive data set. Perhaps there is scope within the devolution of tax to adjust the way that the data is gathered in order to address any perceived gaps in the Scottish data. You also have the devolved power to design the census questions in Scotland for 2021, but also the method of data gathering. Make reference in the report to quite a heavy reliance on online participation. Obviously, the census is only a 10-year snapshot of what's going on in the economy, but in terms of getting a really good picture of what's happening in terms of work and income, those are two positive areas where possibly attention might be paid.
Thank you. And I'll now move on to a question from Jackie Bailey.
I'd be interested in the panel's views on the forthcoming pay gap legislation and whether you think it will make a difference. And I ask that in the context of the Scottish economy largely being comprised of SMEs. And of course, the legislation requires pay gap reporting for 250 plus employees. So, you know, given that context, do you think there is scope for rolling out the legislation in Scotland?
Seem to be volunteered to go first. I think it's very welcome. I will be saying some critical things in the course of our evidence this morning. I think it's important to emphasise the positive. It's a great thing that the coalition government have taken forward. The regulations, I think, are clearer and more effective than the Scottish Public Sector Equality Duty, which places an equal pay reporting obligation on public bodies at the moment. So that we should acknowledge that, and I think review the way that we gather equal pay data in the public sector bodies in Scotland to mirror some of the practices that are in the UK pay transparency regulations. Generally speaking, I think it's a massive positive step forward. I think transparency is very welcome. I think we've seen that public reputation and transparency and image protection, we've seen it in relation to Sports Direct, we've seen it in relation to Uber. Big corporations do not like adverse publicity. Having spent 20 years in mass litigation with tens of thousands of equal pay claims, I'm hopeful that just good old-fashioned transparency will work more quickly than that. The threshold in terms of organisations, the upside of that is that big companies tend to set the benchmark rates for the economy, so that even if small companies aren't caught by the reporting regulations, the big companies, public sector and large private organisations will tend to set the going rate. And if they're compelled, for example, to increase the rate of support workers or care workers because of pressure that comes through transparency, then small organisations will be compelled to follow suit. As we know, because, for example, in social care, the recruitment crisis. So you will get a positive spread effect of the regulations into small organisations, notwithstanding the fact that they're not actually covered. So I'm optimistic.
Thank you.
So just to add to that, I think it raises for me another question, which is what you then do with that information, which I know the committee's been given consideration to. So there is another angle, I think, linked to where big companies, some of the big companies, are securing contracts to deliver services for local government, for the parliament, indeed for other organisations. And so there's something about where you are looking to contract out a service, and we'll come on to this later too, I'm sure, around procurement. The other side of it is, well, actually, are we going to, the pay gap reporting will be there. Will it affect anybody's decision about whether they think that's a good company to give a contract to or not? You know, what do they do with that information? It's a bit like some of the discussion that there's been around blacklisting or some of the other practices. So would it influence your decision to award a contract if you saw a big company had developed good practice and was seeking to reduce its pay gap, you know?
Well, like my colleague from UNISON, I welcome this as well. I think any move towards greater transparency is positive. However, I possibly feel slightly less optimistic than my colleague about what will actually be done about this. Clearly, we would have liked the legislation to go further. It's important that employees are being encouraged to publish this information and an action plan about what they will do to improve their figures. Unfortunately, they're not required to do that. We are witnessing what I can only call the decimation of the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and these are one of the areas where you'd expect sanctions to be provided. You'd expect them to be policing and monitoring this. So whilst this is a step in the right direction, I think without the ability to make sure that this requirement is enforced and then acted upon, it's only going to be a small step in the right direction. Having said that, just again to not sound entirely negative this morning, it is welcome that it's being done. It should be extended beyond employees of the size of 250, because even in the civil service, there are employers representing smaller numbers of staff than that. So again, there's a secrecy around this information that actually isn't helpful.
Well, broadly in line with what colleagues have said, and particularly echoing Cheryl's last point, Prospect's view is that the 250 the 250 level is too high, and we believe that it should be much lower. But if the information isn't collected, then we can't use it. So broadly supportive of more transparency, but needs to cover more people, needs to cover more organisations.
Thank you.
Right. I just wanted to follow up on the question. Certain comment or criticism have been made of the what is seen to be the potential effect of the pay gap reporting legislation. I was just thinking, I don't know if any of you have seen Kate Andrew from the Institute of Economic Affairs. It made some comment, and one of the things that she raised was the point that there's no breakdown of what job an individual is in, what qualifications they have, how long they've been working, or, using her words, any of the other million differentials that could contribute to differences in pay. Now, I'm just wondering, do you think that's fair criticism of this, or we've heard evidence as a committee that workers don't just value the amount they get paid, but also flexible working, for example, if that's available. There are other aspects of a job that may matter to someone who's working, not just the pay. So I suppose there's two parts to the question. One is just addressing the pay gap as a figure, a number, the appropriate approach to the issue, or is there something more to the whole equation? Who would like to?
So I think, obviously, the committee's been considering this for several sessions and reading through all the evidence. It's quite obvious that it's a complex issue. And I think even in asking, when you made that point about other things that people value about their jobs, kind of ironically, if I look at the childcare sector or the social care sector, it's full of people who really value what they do, mainly women, who are not paid in the appropriate manner, but they do the job because they care about the job. You listen to interviews with the skilled workforce, they absolutely passionately care about their job. And as a society, we don't treat that with the appropriate respect and value. So I think it is far more complicated than, obviously, the focus of the inquiry is the language around the gender pay gap, and the statistic is useful. But I think all the evidence you've heard already tells you that tackling it and resolving it is a complex solution. So even that statistic is only part of the story.
I would, with the greatest respect to Kate Andrew, I wouldn't attach any particular weight to what she said. First of all, there's no enforcement mechanism alongside the transparency regulations. If anybody was to litigate on the basis of data that was revealed under the regulations, then the people who Kate's concerned about would have the opportunity to put forward a material factor defence, which is to say that the difference in pay, which has appeared in the headline figures, is attributable to some other factor other than gender, and that's the way that the law works. So that there is a defence in there already. The primary problem I think that we have here is that women and girls do better at secondary school, FE, higher education, undergraduate and postgraduate, and do not convert that into cash value in the labour market. So that if there is an under-recognition or an oversight in relation to the skills and knowledge and talent of people within the labour market, it exists in relation to women, not men. So I think the more transparency we get, the better. We know that there's no point in comparing a 15% pay gap in one company or one nation state with a 16% pay gap in a different company or nation state, because the statistical quality of the statistics doesn't support any observations in relation to that. There's a variance which is possibly going to explain the difference between 15 and 16%. We're all sufficiently intelligent and technically skilled to not assume that the pay gap of 14% in one particular company means that there's unlawful discrimination in there. This is about headline indicators of long-term trends. So, I'm sure her contribution's well-intentioned, but I wouldn't attach any weight to it.
Okay. Cheryl, good.
People that say that workers only work for their salary, don't only work for their salary, aren't people who've never worried at the end of the month about paying the bills or getting their kids to school or whether or not they've got enough money to get to work, which is the kind of thing that our members are reporting, actually. I think it's, whilst I appreciate, and there are things like reward packages and other parts of the employment sector, they do not exist in the civil service and haven't for some time, where you've got people who are fearful on a regular basis of losing their jobs, being made compulsorily redundant, or being moved 200 miles away because an office is closing where they live. So I would share the view that perhaps not too much from a public sector and a civil service perspective weight needs to be given to that. I do think it's important to have the baseline, the basic baseline information, because that does give us from one year to the next comparison information, which is, of course, it isn't the full story, but it is important. But I think, if I can quote a statistic, we've done a piece of research which has looked at civil service pay trends since 2007 up to 2016. And what we're seeing there is that median earnings of female full-time equivalents are still running at 86% of male full-time equivalents. Now, that's not shown within civil service grades, but that's a consequence of an overrepresentation of women in lower-paying grades, which is occupational segregation by any other name. And I think it's the need to kind of recognise that in the work that we're doing, the need to conduct full equal pay audits, which are not being done in Scottish-based departments at the moment, and I have more information about that to share later in the session. And until these things, until a light is shone on these aspects of pay, then we're not going to address the issues that we have.
I think to pick up on Peter's point about academic achievement and the fact that women and girls do better, and yet if you look at the structural position of Scottish industry, we've got 3% of chartered civil engineers in Scotland are women, less than 10% women in senior managerial jobs in engineering, what Equate Scotland calls the leaky pipeline. And those, some of those issues that you raise in your question around flexible working, we would argue that the lack of flexible working in certain sectors is a reason why women don't come into the sector, or when they leave it, don't come back into it, which actually creates the gender pay gap rather than being something that people are valuing and using as a as an alternative value to pay.
Okay, thank you. We'll come to a question from John Mason now.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, that question and your answer, Mr. Hardy, kind of touched on this whole question of occupational segregation, which was the area that I was interested in. I mean, we don't seem to be making a lot of progress in some of these areas. There's a few. I mean, I think solicitors have changed quite a lot. There's a lot more women getting into them. But the care sector continues to be primarily women. The STEM engineering side continues to be primarily men. I mean, what can we be doing? What should we be doing to change that?
Okay, looks like me then. So, as I touched on, workplace policies such as flexible working, transparency over pay systems, transparency of pay on appointment, the evidence would point to the fact that men tend to have higher starting salaries in engineering, but particularly areas that are not covered by collective bargaining. What we've done in Prospect is some work with Equate, which is based up at Napier University, on a number of areas, one of which is looking to work with employers to bring women back into the workforce after they've had a career break, whereby people feel supported to come in rather than once they've left, they're particularly lost to the STEM sector. It's systemic, it's not just in Scotland, it happens across the whole of the UK. And I do agree that there are certain professions which have changed quite a lot over the years, and the legal profession is one. It is not helpful where people come into a science or engineering workplace and there is no transparency about pay. We know that performance-related pay systems can be inherently discriminatory, and eventually women get to the point where you have a choice, you leave to go into caring, or you leave because you're fed up that you're not actually catching up with your male colleagues because of intrinsic problems within the system. Now, until you start to measure that, which hopefully will come partly through the gender pay gap legislation, we can't seek to address it. But you know, it's very clear, as I said, the statistics, particularly for engineering, are very, very poor.
Ms. Henderson, yeah.
Thanks. I get a little bit frustrated sometimes with the conversation around occupational segregation. I know we, the trade union movement, and it's an important analytical tool, if you like, but there has been progress, and I think that we should capture that progress. I mean, yesterday in the paper, there's an article about the next intake of firefighters in Scotland. 14% of those are women, and they interviewed the two women who, as the example of the new pool of recruitment. Skills Development Scotland have done a lot of work to consciously promote women through the modern apprenticeship schemes in all the advertising and the promotional work, and some of the things we would say should be, would be good to do. People are working really hard to try to do that and have images of women in different jobs. And sometimes I think we don't recognise that progress has been made. So I used to work in the railway, and when I worked in the railway, the latter few years I worked in the railway, I was working as a train driver, and there were, you could count on one hand the number of women train drivers in Scotland then. And that's not the case now. You'll all travel on the train, you can travel on public transport, and you will see women working in a whole range of jobs. I think there's maybe an issue about visibility. It's sensible to discuss, both as trade unions and employers, if there are differences and adjustments around health and safety, around uniform, around shift patterns, whatever, which will make it better, prevent problems arising, if you like, because everybody should be safe and secure in their workplace and shouldn't be subjected to harassment or any of the other problems that we know women experience across the board. But I think we should also recognise where progress has been made. It does a disservice, I think, to a lot of the work that a lot of people have been doing to change what the face of the labour market looks like. But I also think, to come back to the point I was making earlier, it's not necessarily a problem that a lot of women work in care and work in childcare. Like, we really value our services there. So it may be a problem that they're undervalued, terms and conditions are not good, there's a slight increase around the use of agency work, and practices are not good. There's been bad employment practices in industries that are dominated by men as well, in construction, for example. And, you know, so the focus of this inquiry around the pay gap and so on, I think we have to be careful to not, you know, like I was looking at some of the earlier discussions, of course we should be encouraging more men to work in childcare and in social care, absolutely we should. But we shouldn't get into a position where we think that we'll wait until more men are there to then increase the wages. 96% of the staff who work in daycare services with children are female. Now, you're not going to change that overnight. So we have to actually look at what we're paying the women who are in the jobs right now. And we have to be careful, I think, with the conversation around occupational segregation, to not shift the focus away from the problem of low pay.
That point, do you think, would you accept that sometimes the trade unions are in a difficult position? Because if you take a big employer like a council, Glasgow City Council or something, I mean, if they're going to start paying the care workers, who are mainly women, more, the men are going to get pulled back who are working in the parks or whatever it is, presumably, to keep the balance in the budget. I mean, has the union not got a bit of a conflict of interest in trying to protect both the men and the women?
I can feel it on my shoulder here.
I coordinated UNISON's single status job evaluation and equal pay strategy for the best part of 10 years. So I've been to the depots where men have had pay cuts imposed on them. Our position is that the male rate tends to be the market rate for the job, and the Equal Pay Act does not provide for the reduction of the male rate in order to achieve equality by levelling down. I think that also denies us the economic benefit of gender pay equality. If you look at what the IMF are saying, or the World Bank saying, even Mark Carney, Bank of England, the problem in the economy at the moment is a lack of capacity in low-income groups to consume the products that the economy is trying to produce. And by levelling wages down to the female rate for the job, we're actually going in the opposite direction to that which the IMF, the World Bank, and the Bank of England would have us go. But yes, so it's an exceptionally difficult position for us to be in, there's no easy solution to that. I think local government is making significant progress. We can maybe come on to the local government experience. I think there's an awful lot of learning there. Focusing on the question in relation to occupational segregation, I think without being complacent, this Parliament can give itself a considerable degree of credit. When devolution came forward, equality was a high priority within the Constitutional Steering Group, for those of you who were around at that time. A prominent solicitor, who's now President of the Employment Tribunal in Scotland, was appointed on a temporary basis to write what I understand to be the first equal opportunities policy for a legislature. We've got good gender balance. We don't only have a large proportion of women as political leaders now, but there's been a number of prominent women leaders of each of the political parties in Scotland in the lifetime of the Parliament. And that has a massive positive effect in terms of what young women might think that they can do in the labour market. So that there's a long game in that sense. But we're up against massive unconscious bias. There's one statistic which I'm compelled to share with you, having done a bit of reading for this, which is that if you look at the Fortune 500 in the United States, 58% of their chief executives are 6 foot tall men. Now, the proportion of men who are actually 6 foot tall in the American society is only 14.5%. Now, I'm pretty sure that I'm not sure they actually have an interview process for selecting chief executives in America, but I'm pretty sure that they don't have a height requirement for chief executives. So there's obviously a very deep-seated unconscious bias there that tall white men are the people who we want to have leading organisations. Now, the evidence I've heard other people quote to yourselves is that there's a correlation between return to equity, productivity and profitability for companies who've got a good gender balance. So we have deep-seated, unconscious, collective processes, and I wouldn't say the labour movement is immune from that. There's maybe other people who would comment on that. UK Labour Party's probably looking like being the last political party to have a woman leader. So this is something that's a collective challenge. It's not a party political point. The key point is Anne's point, which is that while we're addressing that long-term challenge, there should not be a penalty for occupational segregation. And that's what we have at the moment. So that if you're a cleaner in a local authority, and I won't name which one in Scotland, and you clean indoors, you're on grade one. If you're a cleaner and you work outdoors, road sweeping, you're in grade three. Now, I don't understand that, which is why we didn't sign the deal. So changing occupational segregation is a long-term process. People like yourselves play a massive role in that, and I think there's credit for the Parliament in doing that. But in the short term, there must not be a pay penalty for people who choose to work in something that's valuable as social care, as Anna said.
Over 6 feet tall, one of the men. So I'm not going to say anything at this point, but I think Anne Henderson wanted to come back in on this point.
I'm trying to avoid being diverted onto the point about height requirements. There used to be a height requirement for train drivers, and in the 1980s, an agreed train crew agreement was signed, which allowed different members of staff to access the train driver's job, and it removed the height requirement. And actually what happened was there were a lot of very happy, less tall men in the west of Scotland who were able to apply for train driver's jobs. What I was thinking when John asked that question, and Peter used a phrase which probably unintentionally, but around the female rate for the job, which I don't really, I wouldn't use in terms like we would just have the rate for the job, and so understand it's like shorthand for the sort of gap between the types of work that are done in local authorities, but I don't really see why, if you decide, and Scotland is going to have to decide on this question anyway. How are we going to fund the expansion in social care and childcare? 16,000 new full-time equivalent jobs coming through the childcare pledges, early years and childcare pledges the government has made. Welcome pledges. That's a lot of new jobs. Now, it's not a very good headline if it's then the next line is, and this will be paid for by halving the wages of the men that you know who are working in completely different jobs. We're going to have to find a different way of funding the services that we depend on and value. And that was part of the problem in terms of trying to resolve that undervaluing of particular jobs within a small pot. may not be the best way to do it. And I think that that's, you know, there's a big question out there with some specific current government initiatives that require more than saying somebody else will pay for it, your neighbour. You know, it just takes money out the local economy. That's not going to help.
Sorry, I think Cheryl Gedling, did you want to come in there?
Well, just I think obviously these are very, very broad issues around how society values, you know, these employment sectors, and clearly, you know, a lot of work needs to be done to address that. But I think what I want to pick up, it's a point about why would we ask for something that would maybe lead to a levelling down rather than a levelling up. The point that Peter made, I guess if you follow that through to its logical conclusion, we'd never ask for a greater pay increase than we thought we were going to get. You know, clearly we're here to aspire on behalf of our members. And I think what hasn't been mentioned in how we address occupational segregation is the importance of unions and collective bargaining. You know, what is really, really important in addressing this, for instance, is flexible working, which isn't just the hours you work, it's how you work. Could you temporarily work from home? Term time working, which is something unions have fought for, carers leave, all these kind of things, I think, you know, remind us of the importance of strong unions in the workplace. And these are the kind of things that help address occupational segregation as well. And I think in addition to the positive story that Anne highlighted earlier in her contribution about the changes that have been achieved, that this is a really important point for us to highlight as well, the importance of trade unions and importance of collective bargaining and the kind of policies that allow workplaces to be truly flexible.
I think Ash Denham wanted to come in and ask a question that may follow on from what's been being discussed there.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm quite interested in the idea of culture, and particularly, obviously, in this instance, about workplace culture. And I was reading the submission that you sent in from UNISON, which I thought was very interesting. And on page 7, you've got a list here of discriminatory practices that you say are not uncommon. So I'll just read a couple of them. So things like sacking pregnant women, knowingly retaining discriminatory pay systems, manipulating job evaluation schemes, and generally, I like this one, investing time and effort into maintaining the status quo. So I suppose what I'm interested in, firstly, is do we think things are getting better? Is this picture improving? Are these type of practices becoming less common? Or is this still a real, real issue for particularly, obviously, female workers?
Somebody should put me on the clock on this one. I've personally witnessed all of those things, and some of them repeatedly. Some of them have been brought out in employment tribunal evidence. So the manipulation of job evaluation scores and the destruction of evidence of that, the manipulation of those scores, misleading the employment tribunal about evidence that was given to the Equality and Human Rights Commission, misleading the Equality and Human Rights Commission in the course of a formal investigation. The Equality and Human Rights Commission launched a formal investigation into pay at Glasgow City Council. Glasgow City Council is now 12 years into a long-running and already expensive equal pay battle. You might be interested to know what the outcome of that investigation was. I'm interested as well. The investigation is closed, nothing has ever been published. Doesn't feel particularly transparent to me. Now, I'm sure that the basis of the closure of the investigation was entirely satisfactory and completely proper and above board, and therefore there should be no difficulty in publishing the results. So some awful things have happened. We've had, in 2006, Des McNulty chaired a finance committee inquiry into a job evaluation and single status, made various recommendations, most of which were ignored. That was revisited by the Local Government and Communities Committee in 2010 under the chairmanship of Duncan McNeill, I believe. Most of the findings of that were ignored. We're now into the 12th year. There won't be much change out of £1 billion. There's an Audit Scotland investigation at the moment due to report. Well, the Accounts Commission will be reporting in the summer. It's vital that that's open and that the findings of that are analysed and that further action is taken on the back of that. We've achieved a degree of stability in local government. I'm conscious in everything I'm saying today, try to be balanced. The employers and trade unions have worked very positively to revise the job evaluation scheme. That was completed over a year ago with a third edition accompanied by guidance about how to go in and look at some of the hotspots that gave rise to such great expense, and providing that that guidance is followed with enthusiasm and resource, then the positive steps that were made to counteract some of the difficulties that people got into will be very welcome if that happens.
Indicated he wanted to come in.
Thank you, Convener. I think to follow on from Peter, it's a mixed picture. So in some of the bigger companies, I think there's a growing understanding of how job evaluation needs to be undertaken, the need to do it on a regular basis, the need where there is a functioning interaction with a union or a staff committee to involve the union in that process, so there is oversight of it. But on the other hand, we've recently taken a case for a member of staff in a small consultancy organisation, HR manager, who had worked part time, came back into a job after pregnancy, and was told, "Well, the job's full time," and 6-7 years of working part time without a problem, and that cost them quite a lot of money. So I think that. But even in bigger companies, so we have multi-site companies in Scotland where on one site they're very good, and on another site, because the HR manager is different, you get a completely different outcome and a completely different approach. So the cultural change within companies is important. And just perhaps to go back to John Mason's question about unions having vested interests, we were the union that took the Cadman case to Europe on equal pay. In the HSE in the UK, and we achieved success there not by levelling down but by levelling up. And I think Cheryl's answer was excellent, in that it's good strong collective bargaining and involvement within the workplace that ensures that when you get an outcome, that outcome is positive for everybody rather than simply being a levelling down to the thing that we were worried about in the first place.
I agree with the comments that have been made around the importance of collective bargaining, and the Fair Work Convention framework kind of also gives us that to work with. What I was thinking around the question of culture in an organisation, and I think it's important that we all take some responsibility for that, whatever our organisation is. Nobody is in a bubble, really, and I think that like the recent report that the TUC published on sexual harassment in the workplace was quite a surprise, I think, to a number of people, the kind of very high levels of just daily niggling that women were experiencing in the workplace, and then moving on to consequential problems in the workplace. But it'll be people that you and I know that are also responsible for that joking, casual, what becomes quite threatening and unpleasant behaviour in a workplace. So there's something for us all to look at in our work all the time. And then when you're looking at recruitment processes and recruitment panels and how we deal or how we contribute towards tackling this thing about not just recruiting in your own image, that's my shorthand, but that it, recruiting from whom we are most comfortable, and if you're most comfortable being amongst, whatever the environment is, how do you change that? How do we actually build a more diverse workforce with where there is true equality of opportunity? And we just are not getting there. And I hope that some of the questions that have been discussed and emerged through this committee's inquiry will throw some of that up. But the culture question has to be addressed at every level, is really what I'm saying, and trade unions are part of that, but it has to be addressed at every level, and we all have to take some responsibility for speaking up for someone who appears to not have been treated equally and so on. And some of the evidence around pregnancy and maternity leave discrimination is just shocking, absolutely shocking. And the drop in applications to employment tribunals when the charges came in and things tells you a story as well. I would think that new pieces of legislation like shared parental leave theoretically could contribute quite significantly to changing some of the discriminatory practices that exist in the workplace, because it's less hard to tell if, you know, the old adage that a woman of childbearing age may be treated differently through the recruitment process. It's harder to identify if a male worker is about to become a parent through an interview process. So there, and the whole language and drive to deliver services and support for all parents in the workplace could help, but only if we all buy into changing that language and culture.
Coming on that, Convener, I think the cultural change is really important. The difficulty we find ourselves in now is around the impact of huge job cuts, you know, workload issues. I used to hear stories. I used to be a civil servant and formerly worked for some time for the Scottish Government, of people turning up for job interviews with a job clearly stating it could be worked on any flexible pattern, but being told, of course, you understand this is a full-time job. I thought that was a thing of the past, but that's not the case. Actually, I'm starting to hear that kind of anecdotal evidence again. So I think it is really, really important. I think, you know, Anne says the importance of the unions in doing that, and actually people challenging that is the only way we're going to change the culture. But the creeping back of that, I think, is a concern. The way that people are treated returning from sick leave, I am particularly thinking about women here, actually, in terms of some of the particular medical issues that women have. I'm seeing a much harder line, including in the Scottish sector, actually under the control of Scottish ministers, where previously I think real efforts would have been made to look at working more flexibly, look at working in a different way. That's simply not the case now. So we're not going to achieve that kind of cultural change that you're talking about. I think without recognising that, we need to, I think, address these kind of overarching issues and allow people the space, you know, to discuss these things, because managers that we represent as well are struggling, and won't we recognise that? But it isn't okay to be told, I want you to be at work from 8:30 till 5. That's simply not acceptable. And these are the kind of things we're starting to hear again as reps, unfortunately. So whilst having made some progress, I think there's a feeling of a step back actually in the wrong direction there.
I think Gillian Martin had a question that may follow in on this, and then a further question possibly that's related. So I'll let Gillian ask that, and then...
Thank you, Convener. There's a thread going through all the evidence sessions about the gender pay gap being something that a lot of organisations are almost like trying to avoid addressing. And I, in all the sessions, want to tease out from people that come in front of us the actual cost benefit of tackling the issues that you just talked in relation to what Ash Denham's just asked you about. I think it's important to bring out what we see as being an actual productivity reason for organisations, an economic benefit. You've alluded to that, Mr. Hunter, and you mentioned Mark Carney and others. And I'd like to give you all the opportunity to talk about, you know, why should organisations absolutely relish the fact that tackling the gender pay gap would be something good for their organisation?
You've already received evidence in previous sessions from people who are far more expert than I am, but if there is, you've got global institutions like the IMF or the World Bank that say that positive gender balance in a company correlates positively with a better return to equity, then I would have thought companies would be intrigued. Oh, so you've got gender balance and you get a better return on capital investment. Correlates positively with increased profitability. Correlates positively with increased productivity, which is a Fair Work Convention finding for Scotland. Then I think those are high-level macroeconomic business benefits. We can also look at microeconomic level, that if you're giving, and Scottish Enterprise had data back in the 1990s, which shows that people on low incomes spend their money in a way that creates 50% more jobs than people on high incomes. So, and this resonates with Mark Carney's point about the gulf in prosperity and the growth of inequality between the very rich and the very poor actually not making sense from a capitalist perspective, that if people in low incomes don't have money to consume the goods that the economy is producing, then you have a risk of stagnation, which if your economy was more equal, you could avoid. So that it makes good economic sense. Low-paid people spend their money on local goods and services because they've got unmet needs for day-to-day products and services which they can't buy because they haven't got the money, so that you can put money into the economy and therefore create a culture of economic growth. I think McKinsey are saying that we can get 15 billion increase in GDP by 2025 if we address gender inequality. And that's partly through pumping money into parts of the economy where people's spending power creates jobs, grows demand, all of which is good for business. You then have a social policy spin-off, which is not your question, I'm conscious, but increased prosperity for women has a direct effect on child poverty. The best way to tackle child poverty is to address the poverty and inequality that's faced by mothers, not fathers. If you then look into the education reforms, which I think we're all wanting to see improved attainment, there's a close correlation between economic stability in the family unit and educational attainment. So that there are a variety of virtuous circles or positive benefits that can be achieved by addressing it. And how we get people to engage with that agenda, I think, is difficult. All the statistical evidence there, macro and microeconomic evidence, is there.
In terms of bringing it down to an actual organisational level, though, I think there's real benefits to be discussed around eradicating gender pay gap, around reduction in sickness leave, for example, or staff turnover. And I'd like to give you the opportunity maybe to talk about how, I mean, I think, Mr. Hardy, you mentioned that you were doing a study with Napier University. Is any of this being evaluated when you have organisations that are tackling the gender pay gap, so that there is actually a model out there for other organisations to look at to see that this is actually a cost benefit?
Well, I was going to answer in a slightly different way to Peter in drilling down into two areas that I've worked in extensively over the last 10 years. One is in the electricity sector, and the other is in heavy engineering in shipbuilding. So if we take the Scottish distribution system, over the next 10 years, 65% of the staff will need to be replaced. Demographically, it is a largely white, male, ageing population with not really that much incentive to work on past 60. One of the reasons given for those for women not going into that sector is the gender pay gap. Now, if you want to recruit 65% of your workforce over the next 10 years, and actually it's going to need to be over the next 7 years in order to get people up to speed, if you don't fix the gender pay gap and therefore disenfranchise people from coming, 50% of the population from coming into your work, then, you know, that seems to me to be economic suicide. So that there is a clear correlation there. If you fix the system, you take away the reason why, or one of the reasons why, it's not the only reason, but one of the reasons why women say, I don't want to go and be a jointer, I don't want to go and be a linesman, I don't want to go and be a first engineer or second engineer, then you will start to recruit, because this has been a known for the last 10 years, and the recruitment figures are still not great. And the same applies in shipbuilding. So if I look at the west of Scotland, around shipbuilding and around ship support on the Clyde, again, ageing white male population with some issues around gender pay that comes out of our surveys. And part of the pushback to those companies that we're saying is, you need to fix it because you're disenfranchising a whole group of people who are wanting or may want to come and work in your industry. And as Peter said, and as I mentioned earlier, that link of, if women attain better academic grades, then you really are cutting off your nose to spite your face. And the work that we're doing with Equate at Napier is quite small scale. It was a pilot project last year. We've just got funding for a second year. But that has been positive, and we have had buy-in from companies like Scottish and Southern and Scottish Power. But it's reaching out beyond into those companies where there's no collective bargaining, where there isn't a champion to encourage those organisations to change. But, you know, there are clear operational reasons to spend the money to fix it, because it's a disincentive to recruitment.
I'd like to briefly add that there's a mirror between the skill shortages in the economy, in the STEM sectors, but also in technical, managerial and leadership roles, where we have skill shortages, and the areas where women are excluded from the economy. And part of what the McKinsey report is saying is that the dividend comes from addressing the inequality in order to be able to fill the gaps where the skill shortages are. As simple as that.
Just to pick up on your specific point about the benefits, I guess broadly it comes back to the kind of fair work objectives as well. What does it mean to feel valued at work? And pretty broadly, being valued at work means being paid the same for doing the same level, you know, or standard of work as your male counterpart. I think what isn't there, though, is the kind of systematic collection of evidence that you're talking about. For instance, certainly in the civil service, isn't systematic collection of the reasons why people leave the civil service, and they do leave, actually. We charmingly call it turnover. But exit interviews that used to be conducted with staff who are leaving are not conducted anymore. So it's a really interesting point that you raise about the direct link between actually eradicating the gender pay gap and the benefits that you get in terms of attendance, recruitment and retention. It's a piece of work that doesn't exist. It's a piece of work that clearly should be done. Particularly when you look at the increase in pension age and actually the impact of a kind of ageing workforce as well, which I think is something that the trade unions are going to have to pick up, as well as employers. But that has to start with the conducting of full equal pay reviews that don't just look at kind of headline gender pay gap issues, but look at all kinds of allowances that are paid, working patterns, people's access to training and promotion. And these are not being conducted across the Scottish sector at the moment. There hasn't been a full formal equal pay audit in the Scottish Government for 8, possibly 9 years. It'll be having its decade birthday soon. And I think, you know, without that kind of proper systematic collection of information, we're never going to be able to give you a positive answer to that question, other than kind of anecdotal evidence that we have, from a trade union perspective.
Anne Henderson.
One of the things that you said, Gillian, again, I guess it's this issue about whether there's actually evidence or not. I'm not sure that, I don't know what the evidence would be that reflected increased sickness patterns, for example, as a result of a high gender pay gap in an organisation. I haven't ever seen anything that comes at it from that point of view. And I think quite often, anecdotally, but it's not women will be at their work when they probably shouldn't be at their work, as sometimes is the case with men. You know, there's other issues around sickness attend patterns at work.
I think I was talking about the mechanisms to eradicate the gender pay gap. Yeah. One of them, for example, being flexible working, mm-hmm. and that people are probably more likely to take sick leave if they don't have flexible working for reasons that aren't about sickness or about maybe about caring responsibilities or other issues in their life that they maybe.
Right.
So that's what I was really getting.
Okay. In terms of how flexible working is applied, there's one of the discussions we've been having quite a lot, really, as trade unions, is flexible working is important. The regulations and the law, it's optional, but also individualises the problem. So it's to try and get back the balance of how you then have that discussion about what maybe is a repeated individual request, like why is the work start time being changed so it doesn't connect with any of the childcare facilities locally or the bus service. But that it'll come up as an individual problem, but it actually can be resolved and discussed through collective discussion. So I think that's quite important to get hold of. The bigger question about respect and treating workers and paying for the jobs, paying for the rate for the job, irrespective of gender, I think is also linked to a whole lot of other things we have at the moment, like job security and the kind of traditional way that people felt if they go into a particular employer, there would be a career path there, or they would stay there, even being local government, wherever, but they would work and they would have job security and they would have a pension. And those things are what are fragmenting all over the place just now. And I think that makes it very difficult when you're trying to, to take what one organisation is doing, just to pick up on the point we had at the very beginning. We're going to have to really try and identify trends, but recognise that because it helps a smaller number of people addressing one organisation's practice. Do you know what I mean? It's like we need to look at how that's going to roll out because there are big long-life questions, which I can see you've discussed in previous committee meetings, how these things impact over your whole lifespan. And the job security that was a familiar experience for a lot of people in the past, men and women, is gone or is going. And that's what I think I'm interested in looking at, how we get that back, because then we can use those tools to make sure there isn't discrimination in the workplace, in a framework that's steady.
Thank you.
Right. Move on to a question now from Gil Patterson.
Thanks very much, Convener. Does the panel believe that the Scottish Government's 50-50 pledge on gender equality for public boards by 2020 will be met? And perhaps more importantly, what impact will the actual policy have, whether it's met or not?
I think it's important. I would like to see it met. I think the devolved power in the most recent Scotland Act in relation to promoting gender equality is very positive. Having said that, I'm concerned. If you look at what's happened with the Enterprise and Skills Review, which I think has become a bit of a political football, the governance arrangements for the Enterprise and Skills Body are absolutely vital. If we are going to align those agencies to influence respectively higher education, further education, modern apprenticeships, all those key labour market influencers, so that when you have, for example, a direction from the minister to universities, which I thought was a perfectly sensible direction, that the minister expects higher education institutions to deliver certain labour market requirements in amongst all the other things that they do. And that intervention by the minister is attacked on the basis that it is an erosion of academic freedom. The minister, to my mind, did not say anything about what people should think, what they should research, what they should teach, what they should publish. It looked to me from the outside as political opportunism to undermine what was a perfectly legitimate, and in the context of this discussion, a very important direction, which is that we need these institutions to be led and governed in a way which, amongst other things, has a very close eye on gender equality. And if initiatives like that become the focus of attacks of that nature, when we're trying to reform governance and leadership in the public sector as a whole, then the answer to your question might be no, we won't meet it, which will be disastrous.
So, we're not opposed to it. It wasn't, I think there's, we're not opposed to it. The STUC has within its own governance arrangements since the early 1990s had a mechanism that means that at least half of the General Counsel of our organisation is female. And there's ways in which that works and tries to, you know, promote women's representation more through all the affiliated trade unions. Trade unions are working hard in their own structures to try and improve women's representation at all different levels. I think it can be a headline and it will make some difference, but there's the deeper problems that the committee's been concerning itself with, which actually will change work in people's lives and change and rebalance equality in society. I think as well that it's really important to say that as with all people, all women are not the same. And there's a whole thing about disability, about black and ethnic minority representation, diverse women's representation. And I hope that as the boards are reconfiguring themselves and men will be changing as well, and we'll see a more diverse representation from all of our society on public bodies and on public boards.
I'm not wanting to cut the question off, but we do have a number of questions we want to cover. So perhaps if we could move on to the next one from Bill Bowman, please.
Thank you, Convener. If we can perhaps raise our sights to the horizon and maybe beyond it. Are you aware of any innovative practices that have been adopted by other countries to support the reduction of the gender pay gap?
I don't have the details. There are other Scandinavian examples, as I understand it, but I don't have the details in front of me, so it's not the best use of the committee's time.
That's fair enough. Would anyone else like to contribute on this? Cheryl Gedling.
This isn't a practice from another country, but as long as we continue to have pay freezes and pay restraint, we're not going to eradicate the gender pay gap, and I think it'd be remiss to let that go by without saying that.
I'll move on then to a question from Dean Lockhart, please. So, sorry, Bill Bowman, did you want to come back on that?
Just them asking.
Right, well, I'll move on to Dean Lockhart then.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to get the panel's view on the role of older women in the workplace and the challenges that this group face. And in particular, I think it's been touched on before, but not in detail, what actions are most effective at enabling women who take a career break for whatever reason? What actions are most effective in enabling those women to re-enter the workforce in a similar role, the same role, or at a level that they can really contribute in a similar manner as before?
I'll try to be quick. I think this is a massive issue. If you look at the automation and the rise of the robot, of all the occupations that are likely to be affected by automation, large concentrations of women, admin and clerical processing, food manufacture, just they are a target group. We already have a problem that the age variation in the earnings of manual women is the worst of all four categories. Non-manual female workers can expect their income to rise, as can manual men and non-manual men. Manual women's earnings peak in their early 30s and just plateau. And so there's another problem there. Low-paid women in manual jobs will not be able to afford care provision for children or for dependent relatives. So we now have this kind of care sandwich where women perhaps, children take a long time to grow up nowadays, I think 30, 35, by which time elderly relatives are requiring care, so that low-paid women are kind of sandwiched with this care commitment. I was going to come in to Gillian Martin's question earlier on, some fantastic work being done at University of West of Scotland about a different approach to flexible working, particularly in response to the needs of dementia care. I won't go into the detail on that, but it's picks up Anne's point about moving away from individualistic responses to shared responses. But there is a real problem you raise. It's a really important question because older women, many of whom are trapped into the labour market because they don't have the pension provision, which is something we've not discussed at all this morning. The pension gap, which needs to be measured and tracked separately, is a major problem, which is already a significant cause of inequality between women and men. It's likely to increase. And that then taps into all the points we made earlier on about the economic cost of failing to deal with inequality, because that burden then falls on the state, either in in-work benefits for late life working for older women or pension top-ups. So that's an area where I think your question raises a very important point where urgent attention is required for a variety of reasons.
So to follow on from that, if we tackle low wages and poverty pay, and I think other witnesses have referred to that in previous sessions, it could have the most significant impact on some of those longer term problems. I don't think older women in the workforce can be a pretty good thing, I think. That's what we've decided, working amongst a lot of older women. We think we're quite good. But I think one of the things I would say that we've been doing quite a lot of work, the trade unions have, partly because there have been problems emerging with performance management issues, workers struggling to adapt to new technology, different issues, menopause, different health and safety requirements that employers and trade union reps are not well trained in. The profile of the workforce is obviously not what it was in the 1940s. And so there's some catch up to do there in terms of issues that should be talked about to create a health and safe working environment. But actually, some of the things that I see in the trade union movement has been women moving from part-time to full-time work because their immediate family responsibilities are over, or because of the other thing which we've not discussed is how the changing profile of households and the increasing number of single-person households or adult with children, but one wage earner in the house, what that means for the longer-term labour market as well. And actually, you'll see in our trade union reps as well, older women have masses of experience, real tons of experience, know the job inside out, know their company really well, and have more time once some of the childcare responsibilities have passed. So there's got to be a different and better way of I guess managing the whole lifetime of work rather than focusing only on the two or what are perceived as a difficult couple of years, maybe with young children. And I do hope that all parents will find a way of, or all people with child or caring responsibilities will find a way of looking at their own work life over a whole lifetime, rather than focusing only on that one year where there's a crisis and or they need to leave their work. And, you know, we should be able to manage keeping the skills in the workplace in a way that benefits everybody over a longer period of time. And the work with older women will help contribute to that, I think.
Okay. Richard Hardy.
I think if I deal specifically with engineering and technology and refer again to the work we've done with Napier, and I'm quite happy, convener, if you wish to provide a copy of the documentation around that to the committee. Firstly, around flexible work, if you can bring flexible work and get a greater buy-in amongst employers, that flexible working can be achieved not just in the admin sections of their employment. So, because that creates the occupational segregation that we've all mentioned before. So, that's an engineering job; it needs to be done 9 to 5. Oh yeah, you know, you want to work flexibly, well, take this admin job in central office and you can be more flexible. But in terms of reskilling or indeed just regaining confidence, so an example, a civil engineer or an electrical engineer with an HND or a degree has all the basics. They take a career break. The world of work changes. I mean, it's changing ever and ever more faster since the days when I used to be a computer programmer. I'd hate to think how badly I'd make a mess of that going back nowadays. And it's addressing how companies, or indeed the government, or third sector organisations can be incentivised to reskill or reconfidenceise, if that's indeed a word. Women who have the basics, have that basic underlying technical, engineering, managerial knowledge, but are worried about how the world of work has changed while they've been out and how they make that step to come back. And the work we did with Equate has been through seminars, webinars, mentoring, all the things that employers should be doing to encourage people to come back, because that's a pool of people that they don't even have to pay to train. The retraining is a lot less than getting somebody through an HND or an HNC or a degree.
Just really briefly, I think there's some really basic things that can be done, for instance, just keeping in touch with people when they're on a career break, which sounds really basic but doesn't happen in a lot of organisations. And instead of the onus, again, being on the individual, I think organisations should take responsibility for that in terms of valuing that employer. We're starting to see the emergence of health and wellbeing policies, which sound really positive and can be, but there's a focus there on your own personal resilience rather than on the organisational's the organisational responsibility for assisting you through that. I do think it's really, really important for people to be able to increase and or decrease their hours, and sometimes to do that for a short term to help them through a particular kind of period. But the answer to that needs to be yes, we can do it, rather than no one hears why we can't, which is what we increasingly hear as well. So again, I think some of this is about cultural change. You absolutely agree with Anne. Having older women in the workplace is a real bonus, and it's something we should certainly be seeking to encourage in future.
Thank you. We now have a question from Richard Leonard.
I'd like to take us back, as we draw towards the end of the session, to somewhere where we began, which is on the question of low pay. And we know that the five C's occupations, cleaning, catering, clerical, cashiering, caring, tend to be performed predominantly by women. They also tend to be occupations and functions in organisations which are contracted out. So my question is around about the supply chain, and I guess, first of all, whether you have any observations about the extent to which those jobs are contracted out and the impact that that has on the pay rate in those occupations. And secondly, whether there is something which either a private corporate who is contracting out, or indeed the public sector which is contracting out, could do, what action could it take to try to raise up the hourly, weekly and annual rate of pay of those low-paid women workers?
So procurement and tighter regulation, if you like, around contracting services could help. I think there could be conditions included in procurement contracts which were far more specific on rates of pay for the job. But I think that the the whole thing about that, even just that language around the five C's and how we value those jobs, I just really come back to what I said earlier, is we need to look at our own practice as well. The Scottish Parliament itself contracts out its catering services, and I don't know the information off the top of my head about the condition, the rates of pay and the pay gap in the organisations to which the Parliament contracts its own services. Members of the Scottish Parliament have budgets for getting your office cleaned and so on. You know, I think there's a whole thing about how do we actually demonstrate and live by our own aspirations, and how do we rate these jobs in a way that actually values the work that is done? Are we sure that there's pension entitlements when services are contracted out by public bodies? Are we sure that there's agency staff are not being used excessively? There's a whole number of questions which I just think that we should all be asking. Childminders, you know, the services that we all use and our families all use and public money is being used for when policies are decided and agreed by the Parliament, how is the money being spent? And I, you know, I agree with the direction of your question, Richard, that more questions should be asked and there should be more transparency, more public accountability in how that money is being spent.
You raise a very important point. There's been a sense in the conversation so far that the gender pay gap is a kind of neutral problem which has been stubbornly resistant to our best efforts to eradicate it. Not so. Successive UK governments, different political parties, have either failed or deliberately intervened to undermine the position of low-paid women within the labour market. The CHUPI directive, which is, would have addressed your point, due for implementation before Labour lost the election in 1979. They didn't implement it. The Conservatives delayed implementation. When they did implement, it was implemented for commercial undertakings only. So the public sector privatisation went ahead. Equal Opportunities Commission identified in 1995 that it had a direct correlation with increased low paid for women. Nothing was done about that. So that we have had abolition of wages councils, reduced redundancy and dismissal rights for part-time workers, the systematic undermining of the position of that group, which is then fed directly into their pay. The only upside, I suppose, of Brexit is that we can now write our own procurement rules. We do have, for example, if you look at the procurement guidance for social care, you've got an interesting opportunity. Donald Macaskill saying some very interesting things about the need to invest in social care and change the way that it's valued in order to address the recruitment and retention crisis in social care, with consequential benefits for service users, but also for NHS cost management in terms of delayed discharge. We have the beginnings of a framework there. The workforce matters, which can now be competently evaluated, including equality and fair work within procurement processes. UNISON published some research last month, which reveals that some local authorities in Scotland weight or value workforce matters as low as 4% or 5% within the evaluation process. So quality and price occupy 94 or 95% of the evaluation. Workforce matters, fair work, equality, pay, will have no impact on the procurement decisions of those authorities. There is no substantial monitoring and evaluation of whether or not the reported fair work practices of these organisations are actually delivered. So we have the potential to do things very differently to ensure that the problems in, for example, social care or other purchased services are addressed. But at the moment, we're considerably short of what we need to do. And a very helpful finding from this committee would be to review how effective the revised procurement regime has been in the last 18 months and what more needs to be done in order to deliver that step change in the quality of the employment experience of people, for example, in social care or other services, and therefore the knock-on effect of recruitment, retention and care standards.
We'll come now to, I think, our probably final question from Andy Whiteman, and I'll allow each of you an opportunity to answer this one if you wish to. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. I'm just wondering, in wrapping up, whether you have any views on what specific actions the Scottish Government could take within the next few years to reduce and ultimately eliminate the gender pay gap. And I'm thinking particularly, I think UNISON's evidence touched on the Fair Work Convention and less so perhaps in the Scottish Business Pledge, whether there are existing initiatives that could be improved.
We need to have a strategy. We don't have a strategy. People see this as being a devolved issue because equal pay legislation is, sorry, a reserved issue because equal pay legislation is reserved. Not so. Promotion of equality is devolved within Scotland Act 1998. We need to grab that. We need to have a strategy, and people need to buy into that and be held to account for what they do under that strategy. And the powers of the EHRC need to be reviewed. We have the devolved capacity to enhance the powers of the EHRC, particularly in relation to the public sector quality duty. The UK government has trumped the Scottish government in relation to pay reporting. I think that's a gap that shouldn't be allowed to persist for any longer. We should review the public sector quality duty in relation to equal pay reporting against the experience from the pay transparency regulations. We need to review the impact of pay restraint. Pay restraint obviously hits the lowest paid workers. Cheryl's made the point, it does need to be emphasised. We need to look at the impact that has had on pay equality. We've touched on the procurement point already. There, I'll close with the enterprise review. I'm concerned that it's been treated as a political football. We have well-respected, well-established agencies. The purpose of the review is to align them towards particular objectives. One is greater efficiency, one is greater investment and all the rest of it, but one is fairness and equality in the labour market. And if the enterprise and skills review is derailed, as has been attempted so far, we will miss the opportunity to muster the resources, key resources that we've got in the pursuit of higher equality and therefore higher profitability within the economy.
So I think that we need to come back to right at the beginning. We were talking about data and the need for a bit more information. I think that the Scottish Government has to do some more work to get below the economic inactivity figures. What is it? Who are they? What are they? I'm sure they're not inactive at all. Generally speaking, it's because some other reason has caused people to leave the labour market. We need to get in and around that and see if there's gender, what the gender differences are, what the implications are, and how that can be addressed. I think that, I know I've made repeated references to the expansion of the early years and childcare workforce, but it's a key pledge of the government, one to which we are committed trying to deliver as well. But it can't be done cheaply, that's the bottom line. And the biggest message and intervention that could be made over the next 5 years to contribute to tackling the pay gap would be to significantly invest in the workforce, the new workforce. And I'm not talking the living wage. People still live in poverty on the living wage. Children are living, I can't remember the figure, but there's a significant number of the children in poverty stats are with parents who are in work, many of whom are receiving the living wage. So that's not enough. It needs a far more serious injection of funding and resources, which will deliver high quality, good jobs with career prospects and pension fund, you know, payments and security of employment for thousands and thousands of, at this point, primarily women in Scotland, which would be fantastic.
Covering what Anne and Peter have said, I think in terms of the Scottish Government and looking at the Scottish Government as an employer is actually to lead from the front. And I'm going to steal some of Cheryl's thunder, I'm sure, but Cheryl's already touched on it and Peter has as well. An ending of pay restraint, the carrying out of an equality review within Scottish Government and Scottish Government suite of employers, so that employers, when trade unions or activists in other employers go out and talk about equality, you haven't got that ability to hide and say, well, the Scottish Government isn't doing it, why should they be enforcing it on us, which we do occasionally see. And be an exemplar. That's what I would say.
Ditto.
Sorry.
Okay. That's fine. Thank you very much to all of our witnesses. I'll suspend the meeting at this stage to move over to our next panel. Thank you again for coming in today. Well, welcome back to the committee members, and also welcome to our second panel of witnesses here today. I'll start perhaps just in no particular order again. First of all, Val Dougan, welcome, of I think the Equality and Diversity Committee of the Law Society of Scotland. Then we have Kevin Burnett, who is President of the Aberdeen Association of Civil Engineers, of the Institution of Civil Engineers in Scotland. And Dr. Donald Macaskill, Chief Executive of Scottish Care. And finally, but last but not least, Professor Catriona Paisey, Professor in Accounting and Finance at Glasgow University and member of the ICAS Ethics Committee, here I think to represent ICAS. So welcome to all of you. And if I might start the session by turning to Bill Bowman, who has a question.
Thank you, Convener. We usually begin by asking the same sort of question to the panelists. And do you believe that we have a defined set of agreed statistics on female economic activity in Scotland and the pay gap? And taking that one step further, is there enough evidence of at industry level on female participation and the pay gap at industry level?
I should say that the sound desk will operate the mic, so there's no need to press any buttons, and you don't have to come in on every single question, but I'm happy to bring anyone in who indicates by simply raising their hand. Who would like to start us off in answer to that question? Kevin, well, Burnett?
I'll lean forward. Are there statistics? The statistics, particularly in construction, are not too good. It has to be said. I mean, and specific statistics on the gender pay gap are not good. What is measurable is the number of women to men in engineering and construction disciplines, and those statistics are available, and they are not particularly good within STEM sector, as I'm sure you're aware. What will come about is major companies are now gearing up, and we are encouraging them within the institution to be publishing those statistics, precisely those. I work for a major engineering consultancy, London-based. We employ about 300 staff in Scotland. So I know the statistics for the number of females in my company. But and the Institution of Civil Engineers will tell you the statistics for the number of females chartered engineers in the UK, which is less than 4%, I believe. However, when you get to the numbers of under 40, then that may jump to nearer 20%. But those statistics are hard to come by at the moment. So if you want to set targets, you have to know where you're standing and a plan to get there. And that is obviously part of the issue right now.
And from the Law Society's perspective, we've actually carried out a sort of census of the profession, and the last one that we did was in 2013. So we do have, and that there was over 3,000 responses to that. So that does provide a sort of reasonably accurate depiction of what the earnings levels are within the legal profession within Scotland. And we've been very open and honest about the fact that we do have quite a sizeable pay gap at 42%. And that was something that we came out with publicly in 2015 with a view to doing further work around that and actually implementing voluntary equality standards to try and get the profession to address this. So certainly within the legal profession, we do have a lot of data in relation to earnings.
If I can talk about accountancy, there is data. It's not always joined up data, I think. The reason for saying that is there's data, first of all, from the Financial Reporting Council on the professional bodies. So I can give you ICAS data, for example, from that. ICAS has roughly 21,000 members, about a third of whom are female, that percentage will rise over time because obviously in the early years there were very small numbers of females joining the accountancy profession. We're now at a situation where over the last 4 or 5 years the numbers of trainees has been roughly in a ratio of female around about 41% to 44% out of the total. So we're not at parity, but we are approaching that sort of level. So the figure of one third females will increase over time as these people progress through the profession. In terms of pay gap, it's difficult to get completely comprehensive information. As members of the committee here may know, accountancy is tends to be dominated by four large international firms known as the Big Four. So these are PwC, Deloitte, EY and KPMG. And they each do publish their pay gap data. At the moment, that pay gap tends to be between about 15 and 20% when you just take average male versus average female earnings. They also disclose it on a different basis as well when they compare across grades. So if they will compare, for example, trainees or newly qualified people, managers, directors, and so on, when you actually look the pay gap grade for grade, then the gap comes down to something between 2 and 6%. So I think there are a number of issues going on. There's obviously some structural issues within that pay gap. So in terms of your question about the reliability of data, we have some data from professional bodies, we have some from large firms, but of course a very large number of accountants don't work in professional practice. There's about twice as many people work just in industry and commerce as in public practice. And for them, it's very difficult to get data because their data will be wrapped up in the individual companies and organisations in which they work.
In social care, as members will know, we have an 86% female workforce. We have clear evidence that there isn't a substantial pay gap. The pay gap which exists is a gap between reality and practice, in that, as we at Scottish Care have said on a number of occasions, in a predominantly female workforce, there are real challenges of horizontal segregation and occupational discrimination, which negatively impact on the ability of women to continue to work in social care and on the ability and desire of men to be attracted to come into the sector.
Well, thank you for that. It seems, I think, that we found elsewhere, there are pockets of data, and trying to correlate them is a challenge that we need to address. Thanks.
And now to Jackie Bailey.
I accept a lot of what Dr. Macaskill has said, but let me nevertheless look at pay gap reporting legislation, which is due to come in shortly, and just to get the panel's view on whether you think this will be useful, whether it will make a difference to the pay gap. And I ask that in the context that Scotland is largely an SME-driven economy, so we will have typically less than 250 employees, which is the threshold. So in commenting on that, would you also perhaps tell me whether you think there is scope to do more in Scotland than is currently proposed across the UK? And I'll take you in any order.
Who would like to start? Dr. McCaskill.
Okay. Respond to that. As Ms. Bailey knows, the social care sector in Scotland is predominantly SME, with one or two larger corporate bodies, both in the care home and in the care at home sector. I think, despite what I've just said about the lack of a real, what we might describe a classical pay gap, there is concern amongst some that the 250 level is not going to get us to where we want to after several decades of equal pay legislation. But given the context of social care, that's perhaps more of a challenge for other sectors than it is for us.
Within accountancy, I think we have a situation where I think we have evidence from other examples that actually disclosure does work and does bring change. If I think back to when I was training as a chartered accountant, for example, we had hardly any social and environmental reporting whatsoever. And now virtually every organisation over a certain size produces a sustainability report, environmental reports, social reports and so on. We're now starting to get human rights reporting, which again, you just never saw a few years ago. So to answer the sort of question in principle, you know, does disclosure affect circumstances? I think absolutely yes. I think once an issue becomes visible, then people will want to start to tackle it. So I do think that the requirement to have gender pay reporting is going to be very useful. In terms of the Scottish situation, if we actually, of course, some of the big accountancy firms are UK-wide, so they may meet the threshold of 250 employees on a UK-wide basis. But if we just actually looked at the Scottish situation, there's only actually five accountancy firms that have more than 250 employees. If we actually dropped that requirement down to 200 employees, that would still only take in another two accountancy firms. So I think that the Scottish situation does make it difficult because of the fact that lots of firms have got significantly lower figures than 250. So I think that the changes are welcome. I think the visibility is welcome, but I don't think we should overstate the effect. I think we're still only going to be seeing the very top of that pyramid.
I think from a legal perspective, that definitely it's that whole adage, isn't it? What gets measured gets done. And I think, I'm sure you'll have heard that in here. So I think it will be very helpful to actually see figures and for people to, in the legal profession, to actually have some sort of comparative analysis against their peer group. I think the fact that they will have sort of sector league tables will certainly be helpful. We were discussing before we came in today about whether we had that information that you've just sort of said in relation to how many law firms would be captured at 250 plus. And because the Law Society only sort of records in relation to lawyers, so we don't know how many other employees, so we are not able to sort of see X amount are going to come under the legislation at 250. What I can see is that when we developed our own voluntary standards, we put the benchmark at 150. And I certainly know that within the Scottish public sector, it's 20 now, it's been dropped to. So I think there is potentially scope to go below that 250. I think from a UK perspective, that they said when the regulations came in that it would only cover 34%. Of the UK workforce as a whole, and so translating that into the Scottish economic model, I would imagine it will reduce further. So that might be something that we see going forward, you know, whether that level reduces. But I think as a first step, I think it's really important because I don't know of any law firms that currently report on their gender pay gap. So I think actually even getting the larger firms to do that will actually be helpful as a sort of step forward.
Yeah, I think in the construction sector and in engineering generally, the high level of subcontracting will cause an issue here. Not many companies, maybe the larger consultants, but even the largest contractors in Scotland, many of them will not employ above that threshold. So I think there is a case for the threshold to be reduced, so similar to what Val was saying. I'm not aware of any companies yet who do issue that information within construction and engineering, but I do know that a large number of them are gearing up for this. We are encouraging them to do it voluntarily, and we're encouraging them on the basis that understanding the issue, they can start to do something about it, and there are clearly tangible effects, advantages in doing something about it and closing it down. So yes, I think there's a significant issue with what's being brought in and actually capturing enough information for it to be valid, I think, within construction and engineering.
Thank you.
Thank you. We've talked about statistics, and Gillian Martin has a question about productivity, I think, that would be good.
good to bring in at this point.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. It kind of comes off the back of actually what Kevin Burnett just said about tangible advantages. And I'd like to ask each panel member what, why is it in your sector's interests to tackle the gender pay gap? I mean, it's not just the right thing to do in terms of equality. It actually does have tangible effects on your sector. So I'd like to give you the opportunity to outline them for your sector for me. And of course, occupational segregation as opposed to gender pay gap for Mr. Macaskill, potentially.
Who would like to go first?
I mentioned it.
Very well, Kevin Burnett.
I'm learning the process.
Yeah, process for all of us, I'm afraid.
There are. There's advice. There's industry advice that clearly a more equal, diverse, and inclusive community performs better across a whole host of metrics, and that has to appeal to private sector companies. And private sector companies are aware of this. Certainly within our company, it's there, and it's there in again major contractors. I would suggest they do understand it. Some of them are struggling to believe it, perhaps. But a more diverse community makes for a better community. We're absolutely convinced of that within the institution. And there is a real requirement for cultural change. And there's a lot of arguments to be made on that point. Profit levels are the ones that speak loudest. And there is evidence from various sources that actually your profitability will go up, and that is the hardest hitting message, let's be blunt, in certain circumstances. But there are a lot of other metrics that that really do count beyond profitability, one of the biggest drivers in any EDI community that you have in your profession or your company, whatever it is, staff engagement is clear. And when staff are engaged, they will tell you that message first and foremost, that that's what they're looking for, is more cultural balance, more equality, more inclusivity. And they will start to tell you the benefits of that, and you realise them for yourself. And we have in our company seen the benefits of it. We can drill in to good, well-performing teams, even on that basis, and give examples of that. That the more diverse a team is, and it's not just the gender balance, the better it tends to perform.
I would say in the legal profession, one of the particular issues that we've discovered from doing this sort of profile of the profession is this kind of problem in relation to female progression. So we don't have the same sort of issues as construction in terms of entry level into the profession. 51% of the profession are female, and in actual fact 60% are under 40 that are female. But when it comes to the partnership level, it's only 28% of partners are female. So our issue is about going up the way and the pipeline. And so we have a lot of women at traineeship level, sort of assistant and associate level, and less at the partnership level. So progression, and if you put it in that sort of parlance, the vertical occupational segregation is the kind of issue for us. So we want to see action and taking steps in relation to that. So that's
supplementary question. I mean, if you're making the argument for law firms to address this issue in terms of actual cost benefit,
what would you say? The issue is that we lose female talent if we don't continue to keep them into partnership levels. So that is the main, I think, driver in terms of kind of going forward, that if we don't continue to have women working through to this very senior levels, then what's happening is at sort of the senior associate level through these surveys is that they're quite often going into in-house roles or they're going into public sector roles. So there is, undoubtedly economic benefits in relation to being an inclusive workforce, but it makes absolutely no business sense to have women working for 10, 15 years and being incredibly successful, but losing them at partnership level. So there's a real sort of talent issue for the legal profession. Thanks.
I think that talent issue is actually the same in accountancy. There's, you know, it's an odd system, isn't it, where lots of people come in at lower levels, but then they're not represented at the same sort of proportions higher up. So there's obviously something going on there. So I think talent is a real issue. I think within the big four accountancy firms, there's a very strong interest in diversity. I would say it's not just gender. There's a lot of work going on at the moment in things like social mobility, ethnicity, age factors, disability, you know, a whole variety of things. And it's certainly very often said that a more diverse workforce is a better workforce. It's a more profitable workforce. I'm not absolutely convinced that we have hard evidence for that. I know it's often said, but I think it's difficult at the research level to unpick whether it's the fact that it's a diverse workforce or whether that company just has other attributes which make it do well that you know are driving greater profitability or whatever. So I would say that diversity is just one of a package of things which companies can do, but I would be reluctant to say that, you know, if you have a more diverse workforce, you will increase your profitability. I don't think it's as straightforward as that. But certainly, I think the firms are very aware of the fact that they want their workforces to be more inclusive, to be more representative of the general population. And I think that there is this huge concern with this talent wastage that Val has talked about. So I think that that's something that probably applies across a lot of professions. I think it applies in teaching, for example. There was just something last week about the fact that lots of teachers are female, but actually there's still more heads who are male in proportion to the total workforce than there would be if you know, if females were coming through.
Slightly different in social care. The social care desire and need to diversify the workforce isn't because of the profit line or to increase a capacity, but it's to maintain survival. We have, as I've already stated, an 86% female workforce. That workforce, on average, is over the age of 45, predominantly a significant group over the age of 50. Literally, unless we begin to recruit a much more diverse workforce, and that includes women, despite the 86%, then we will not be around in 10, 15 years' time. The UK statistic is that we need 700,000 additional social care workers, even with the progression of technology-enabled care. 700,000 by 2037. The Scottish equivalent of that is roughly around about 80,000. I really don't know where they need to come from. I know where they need to come from. I don't know where they're going to come from, because at the moment we are losing workers because of age, because of lots of reasons that I've spoken about elsewhere in terms of worker stress, etc. So it's not an option. It's a fundamental need to diversify the social care workforce.
Thank you. I think we'll come on to a question from Andy Whiteman now.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of questions. I mean, first, following Jackie Bailey's question about the new legislation, we had a previous witness, Anna Ritchie-Allen from Close the Gap, told us that she'd attended three employer events delivered by law firms in relationship to the new legislation, and each event included informal advice on how restructuring an organisation into corporate groups would reduce the employee headcount and therefore avoid because the regulations don't require companies structured into corporate groups to use the overall headcounts, that allows them to avoid it, and also that employers could consider promoting higher paid employees into an LLP, as is often done in law firms, and therefore they'd be excluded. I mean, is this kind of advice that you're familiar with that would appear to undermine the intention behind the new legislation?
I can certainly speak on. I've certainly not seen anything like that, and I work in a large law firm that advises clients in relation to the regulations, and that's certainly not been any of the views that I've seen in relation to it. I think most people, even that are on the kind of cusp of the threshold, are looking at it with a view to reporting. That seems to be the direction of travel, and that transparency is really here, and you know that is something that they want to apply. So I have not seen any kind of attempts at all to try and get out of that situation, but I don't know if that's...
I would endorse that. I've certainly not heard of anything of that nature within accountancy. I think that there is concern that there are gaps. The big four accountancy firms have voluntarily disclosed some information. It's obviously not as extensive as it will be once we get the full reporting regime coming in. But I sense a willingness actually to look at this issue. And as I said before, it's not just gender, but there's also a willingness to look at other aspects such as social mobility and other diversity issues as well. So I've certainly not heard of those sorts of manipulative behaviours.
I can think of people coming along to our seminars who were at the sort of 200 mark and were very much thinking that they were going ahead because their peer group were, and so they didn't want to be left behind. And so I think if we start to shift the mindset, the default, that transparency is the norm, then the sort of view will be, well, why aren't you doing it? So that's certainly been their view. They wanted to get a grasp on it because they were going to do it themselves. So I've certainly not seen any kind of avoidance measures. I think that would be quite complex to go and set yourselves into a different sort of corporate structure just to avoid reporting.
My next question is about your own gender pay gap for your own industry. I think the Law Society, you've provided us with a figure of 42% for full-time. And if you can't provide the figure now, I wonder if you could perhaps apply it to the committee later across part-time, full-time, all workers, mean and median.
That could be quite challenging in the construction sector. I mean, I'm here representing the Institution of Civil Engineers, the Institution of Mechanical Engineers, the Institution of Electrical Engineers, etc., chemical engineers, ad infinitum. It's quite a siloed sector. So at the moment, I can't give that. Interestingly, we were discussing that metric, and amongst chartered engineers, in the civil engineering sector, there seems to be a slight pay gap in favour of chartered female engineers over chartered male engineers. But that may be because the group you're selecting is so small that it may come out with a statistical variance. But my understanding is that, for example, the Institution of Mechanical Engineers, the pay gap's 11% in favour of males over females. Getting that across the sector is difficult, but for the Institution of Civil Engineers itself, yes, we should be able to do that. Certainly companies will be able to do that, individual companies. I was going to just very briefly quote the Women in Science and Engineering advice. There's a 10-point plan that we are trying to encourage all our sort of member organisations to adopt, and some of them are already doing it, and one of those 10 points is understand the starting point so you can monitor progress. So your earlier question, if you're not prepared to understand the starting point, you can have no progress. So it very much gives, I would echo what the other speakers have said. This seems a very retrograde step, the examples that you're giving, and it's not something that we've seen.
In terms of social care, as I've said earlier, the size of the sector is such that it's difficult to gather that sort of data because it's not really an issue. The issue is occupational segregation. But where there is a pay gap, and if I speak to frontline workers, the gap they talk about is the gap which I receive as somebody working for a charity or a private organisation for doing the same work that somebody down the road is working for an in-house public authority. That's where the gap exists.
In accountancy, I quoted earlier sort of global figures in terms of the big four firms reporting a gap of something in the order of sort of 15 to 20%. But once they adjust those by grade, it comes down to something like, you know, roughly about 2 to 6%. at the beginning we were asked if data exists, and I think it's beyond that that there's it's difficult to get further granularity. So we don't have data, I think, in terms of splitting gender figures by grade, then by age, and other factors, full time, part time, as you said. I think as with construction, I think that employers will undoubtedly have this information. Individual CA practices or other companies, whether it's financial services or whatever, that are employing large numbers of accountants, they will have that employment information. But I don't think the professional bodies have that information, because they are not the employer. They're the professional organisation, but they're not the actual employer of the individual.
Thank you. And we'll now come on to a question from Ash Denham.
I'm interested in hearing, I know we've possibly touched on it already, about what your organisations or what your sectors are currently doing in order to address the situation and try and see some improvements. And I noticed from the submission that we received from the Law Society, you said that several things have been done. So a campaign on progression, obviously to get women into the more senior positions, interviews with senior women as role models to see if that would help, obviously publishing the pay gap. For you, I was wondering if Val, you might be able to share with us if you think those have been successful, or whether there are other things you think could be more successful.
Yeah, I think we've done that, but we've also published the equality standards, which is a sort of framework for law firms to sign up to, and that contains within it this kind of idea of and having an equality lead. So this idea of accountability at senior level, and having an equality strategy, so actually setting out an action plan for what you want to achieve, and also so it's 10 standards, and so within that it's got the gender pay gap standard, which applies to firms with over 150 employees. It goes slightly further than the UK regulations by asking for reporting at part-time and full-time and at various levels of seniority. So that was introduced voluntarily in 2015. So that has been one of our main focus in trying to sort of push firms into signing up on a voluntary basis to try and take action. So far, 21 firms have signed up to that. So we did that in 2015. That's under review next year. And we are obviously hoping that with the UK regulations coming in, that a lot more firms will be caught under the 250 threshold, so we will see further measures taking place there. So there's been a variety of voluntary initiatives that we have looked at. We also do training for the new partners, so they learn about the equality standards to try and embed them in their firms as well. We've got a couple of sort of equality events coming up, one in May and one in June, about women in the legal profession and equality within the profession. So there are lots of things that we are trying to do. You know, this is very much on our radar as a profession. But I think with all of these things, it's about sort of taking time for it to actually have an impact.
Within accountancy, I think there are a number of things that are happening. In terms of progression through the ranks, I think, again, not just the big firms, but other firms as well are very concerned to make sure that there are pathways right up to partner level. If we look at the big four firms at the moment, something between 13 and 17% of partners are female, and those firms have set targets over the next 2 or 3 years to get up to something like 25%. 25% is still nowhere near where we might argue where it ought to be, given the numbers of females coming in to the profession initially, but it would be a step change from where we are at the moment. And there are various strategies going on to try to facilitate that, mentoring, leadership programmes, those sorts of things. So that is happening. I think the targets that have been set for percentages of managers and senior managers are now more or less met. I think where the targets still have to be met are at the director and the partner level, so some progress is being made. There are other things as well. If somebody takes a career break, for example, then the firms have introduced return to work schemes. They will often have paid internships for perhaps 12, 16 weeks, something of that nature, and people are able to apply for positions at the end of that. So there are a number of things going on. But one of the things which I think is quite difficult, and research shows this, is that often the catalyst for differential sort of career progression is if a woman has a maternity break. There are positive and there are negative stories. There are some very, very positive stories of very good conversations taking place between women in that position and an employer where they can discuss what the career aspirations would be and what kind of work the women would like to do, and they can put together a package which probably has a little bit of flexibility on both sides, but which is designed to work for the individual, and the individuals who have those kinds of arrangements talk very highly of them. But there are also, of course, negative stories where people say, well, I asked for part-time or whatever and I wasn't allowed to get it. One of the things that the research shows is a real problem, though, is that if a woman takes time out for a career break to look after her children, if she then wants to go back in a part-time capacity, those kinds of jobs simply are not advertised. Often part-time work is something that people negotiate when they're with an employer. So they might say, well, I would like to come back, but could I come back, working mornings only or 3 days a week or whatever it is. And you can often do that if you're negotiating with your current employer, but if you take time out completely, then jobs are simply not really advertised on that basis. It's quite rare to see an advert where it will actually say that flexible working is suitable in this particular post. So I think that's something that probably requires more cultural change, but I think it would be really useful for employers to make it clear that there are many jobs that they have that actually can be done on a flexible basis, but people just feel that they can't apply for them because the job is advertised on a full-time, permanent basis.
Where companies, firms, or organisations can evidence it, it's very powerful. If you don't mind, I'll quote Carillion. Managed to increase their maternity return rate from 76% to 96% by introducing more flexible working, agile working practices. And that included home working, parental leave, greater part-time working, special leave and time off for dependent care. Those are the sort of practices that are introduced can give a clear metric, as they've just done. It doesn't tell you in what capacity the maternity returners came back, but they will quote that 84% of staff, by having staff engagement survey, which is absolutely critical, will recommend Carillion as employer, and they're on target to increase their women in leadership positions within that company to 30% by the year 2020. So keep going back to the same thing, which is having the metrics in the first place and showing it. But that is, on the face of it, a clear success story, which follows on exactly from what Katrina was saying.
Again, it's a bit different in social care. The last substantive bit of research showed that 9 out of 10 people thought that it was okay for a man to do a job of care. But the same research showed that 2/3 of parents would not encourage their son to enter into a career of care. And that 1/3 of the 16 to 25-year-olds, when asked, would you want to work in care, said no. And then another 1/3 didn't know what social care was. So there are huge issues around societal stereotyping and gender stereotyping around social care. Obviously, as an organisation, we work very hard to dispel the myths that men are unable to care, are unable to offer dignity to an individual at the end of their life, and are unable to be sensitive in terms of somebody's individual personal needs. But these are very, very deeply rooted societal assumptions. It's okay to have a male doctor or a male psychiatrist, but a male care worker seems to be a step beyond. Unless we bridge that societal stereotype, then we are really in social care going to be faced with massive challenges in the very near future.
Thank you. Perhaps I could just clarify something, and this is directed to Val Dougan, to do with the Law Society and the solicitor's profession. The Law Society paper comments on the Equality Act, and I think you've referred to what's set out as the simplistic notion of formal equality, and then this being said to be compounded by a number of factors, one of which is occupational segregation. So would you agree that occupational segregation can cause a difficulty in terms of this area?
In our profession, it's obviously different from Donald's situation. It's the vertical segregation, and so it's very much about how the women are distributed in the legal profession. So that is definitely a major factor in why we have such a large gap. That 42% is because we have fewer women at the top, and a great deal of them at the bottom and the mid-tier, and that's having that impact.
Yes, I mean, that's what I was really wanting to look at, how the situation will unfold going forwards, because your intake, I'm just taking the figures from your annual report, I think the figure of female solicitors in Scotland has gone up to 52%, the 2016 report. Newly admitted solicitors, 65% are female and only 35% male. So looking to the future,
Our law students are female.
Yes. So looking to the future, the problem is not going to be there's not enough women in the legal profession, whatever happens with the pay structure. But ultimately, does that not mean the solicitor's profession in Scotland will become a segregated profession, predominantly female? And does that not cause problems going forwards? If we think of studies that have identified falling pay, I think there's a recent US study being associated with sectors that become predominantly with positions occupied by females. So I'm just wondering what the Law Society's doing or its approach, because I think it's recognised with Scottish Government, the Scottish Funding Council, and I think even the Law Society, I think your colleague Rob Mars wrote an article, which I think you refer to in your submission to this committee.
Right.
And he identifies some of the problems, which interestingly enough are similar to the problems, but the opposite way around, that Dr. Macaskill referred to, being young males don't view the law as being a profession to go into, which is the opposite of the problem
we
suggested.
Have an interesting situation there, and that was actually one of the points that was raised in our Let's Talk Progression campaign, which was not just obviously looking at the sort of gender imbalance that we have at the moment, but do we need to get to a situation where we are actually actively encouraging men into the profession, which will be something that we potentially have to look at going forward, because it's been this situation now for quite some time that we have this imbalance at entry level. So, I mean, that is something that is within the society's sort of viewpoint. And we do acknowledge that sort of going forward, that might be something that we do have to look at. But I certainly haven't had any discussions about what the increasing feminisation of the legal sector will bring towards wages. I mean, that's not something that's really within.
I mean, that would be a question of looking at the content of fees, or possibly even legal aid fees and other fees that are paid to solicitors now for particular lines of work, would it not?
Yeah. It's not something that I would be able to comment on in terms of earnings at this stage.
Fair enough. Could I also ask about the question of paralegals? Do you know what percentage are male, what percentage are female? Because I think the annual report, certainly the web version, indicated there were 434 paralegals, and that's as opposed to 11,500 roughly solicitors. And I'm just wondering whether that disguises another
question about, you know, percentages and who is paid what for work that is essentially legal work that 25 years ago would have been done by qualified solicitors.
Well, there is a sizable shift in the profession. That's not something that we hold information on. As I said, the information that we gain in our census relates to the returns from solicitors. But I can certainly ask, and that might be something we might be able to follow up in writing, but it's not something I have available to me just now in terms of paralegal information.
Okay, well, that would be very helpful if you could follow that up.
Yeah.
I think Dr. Macaskill wanted to...
Just a general comment. We often hear the term feminisation of the workforce addressed to social care. I think it's unfortunate that we equate and associate feminisation of our workforce with low terms and poor terms and conditions. Much rather, we would want to see in social care the fact that our workforce is not truly representative and sufficiently diverse is in itself because of the low pay and the poor terms and conditions. And I think we've got to, when we have discussions around gender pay gaps, be very careful that we don't equate a female-dominated workforce with a workforce which should be paid less, because unfortunately, after 30, 40 years since the establishment of the NHS Act's created home helps, that's what we have unfortunately seen.
That is precisely what I was trying to get at, because the question in particular was if one has segregated workforces one way or the other, rather than more balanced workforces, if one can put it that way, whether or not having more balanced workforces would tend to assist in ensuring fairness of working conditions and pay conditions.
I think I said when I last appeared before the committee that if the social care workforce in Scotland was more balanced and more representative of the community, or dare I say, like the legal profession at the moment, in some elements more male-dominated, we wouldn't be a low-paid profession.
Can I just make a brief point? It's really sort of picking up on the horizontal segregation, which seems to exist in some other areas. I think that actually, you know, perhaps many professions do have this within accountancy. I can think of some research that one of my colleagues at Glasgow has done, for example, looking at the insolvency section within accountancy, and there are some very clear gender issues there, and often women don't, you know, choose not to go into insolvency. Perhaps it doesn't always suit their lifestyle. You know, you might be, you know, suddenly told that you've got to go hundreds of miles away next week, in the next hour, because, you know, a firm has, got into difficulties. So there is some horizontal segregation, I think, within accountancy, and people always used to say that tax was something that was more typically done by females, insolvency by males. Now, I think these are generalisations, and obviously the situation changes all the time, but I think actually within the subsections of probably lots of professions, there are certain areas that prove more attractive to one gender rather than the other.
Thank you. Move on to a question from Gil Patterson.
Much, convener. Are the panel confident that the 50-50 target for gender diversity on public boards will be met by 2020? And since this is the public sector, what do you think the private sector will react? What reaction will they take to this?
Professor Paisey.
I think in terms of the private sector, I think, again, this is a very live issue. I wouldn't like to say that they'll make 50-50. I know that there are international examples. I think Norway led the way, but there's now something like 10 other countries as well, I think, where there's a real, you know, concern to balance boards. I know ICAS has done some research on balancing the board, but they've actually looked at other aspects as well, not just gender, but also age and ethnicity. I think this is something that all companies are working on. But I think that within the various debates that take place, I think there are two arguments. I mean, some people say that there should just be positive discrimination in order to make those targets. And other people say that, well, they want people to be appointed on merit, but they want to make sure that if there are structural constraints that stop certain sections getting into those positions, then you know, things ought to be done for that. I think within boards, if you look at FTSE 100 boards, for example, then there's a concern that actually females are coming onto boards, but very often in non-executive roles rather than in executive positions. So I think that's another form of segregation which also needs to be tackled. So it's not just a question of balancing the numbers, but it's actually also a question of looking at the roles that people are undertaking when they're on those particular boards.
In the construction sector, that will be would be a difficult target. I think your question was about the public sector, wasn't it?
Well, it's the public sector, but of course the fact that there's a target and there's a work towards that, I'm just wondering if this will encourage the private sector to follow suit, maybe more rigorously.
I certainly think it will encourage it. The target itself, I know within my own company, we have 28% of all technical staff are female, but at the top grades of the company, that falls to 9%. So the targets that are set are not 50% by 2020. I think that would be in probably most companies, I would hazard, that might be considered an unrealistic target in the construction sector, given the relative numbers. I think our opinion is that organic growth is the most stable. So organic ways of doing things, imposing measures and determining what measures are in position and what measures are organic is quite a key question. What is growth within the company and what's something that's seen as an imposition on the company? And companies, elements of a company will always resist that, what they see as an imposition. Mm. And some of that comes into conscious biases.
I think it does depend where you're starting from as well. And as I understand it from the public board's consultation, I think that the public boards were sitting at over 40% anyway, and so reaching a 50% from that starting point is, on the face of it, seems potentially achievable. It depends how big the boards are and how many times vacancies come up, because if you've only got a small board and you've got several years in terms of tenure, it just might not physically be possible for a public board. So I think that the starting point matters. And certainly we've not seen the same sort of activity levels within the private sector. But I do think that making these steps in the context of the public sector is really helpful, because it raises the awareness, and I think that's always a good thing. So it'll be interesting to see how many private sector firms actually do sign up to the 50-50 by 2020.
Difficult to answer that question for social care, where the majority are SMEs and many are not don't have boards or limited companies. But certainly, given that so many SMEs originate and are managed by a woman director and are created by groups of women, there is a greater challenge to attract men into even serving in those boards and committees which run organisations or charities.
Thank you. Question from John Mason.
Thanks very much, Convener. I was interested, Dr. Macaskill, in your answers to some of the previous questions. I mean, if I understood you correctly, the issues in your being a primarily female workforce would be both societal, and if there was more money, it might actually attract more men. And I suppose I'm thinking just now mainly of the societal side. How can we go about changing that? And are schools part of the answer to all of this? I mean, we've got a bit of a tendency, I think, sometimes that every time we've got a problem, we just ask the schools to fix it, which is a bit unfair. But, I mean, do you think, both on the STEM side, the schools should be doing more to encourage women down that route? And on the care side, should the schools be doing more to encourage guys down that route?
The answer is yes. But it's not just, given the proportion of time that a child spends in school compared to at home, it's not just down to education. It is a lot of the debate around gender pay gap and a lot of the debate around horizontal segregation hasn't really been properly informed by the psychology of discrimination and the way in which individuals develop their negative attitudinal frameworks and how early that happens. Now, child psychology would teach us that a child by certainly two or three has developed a lot of the attitudinal framework with which they will journey through life. Now, if in those very early years, care is seen as something which is female, and nurture is an activity which is possessed by the mother rather than the father, it doesn't really matter what early year educators or indeed school educators do, because those attitudes have been framed. So there is a lot which we need to do, yes, in education, and there are good models where children are invited into care homes and to care at home companies to see the reality of what care is, and that goes all the way through into secondary. But I think there needs to be a much, much more fundamental discussion had in wider society about what are the values around care which are not suitable for a man, or the which are not deemed to be masculine. Because in the end of the day, there is an increasing drive to technology-enabled care and to technology to plug the gap with human absence. But if I'm dying, I don't want my hand to be held by a machine. I want a human being there. But that's only going to happen if we change our attitudes as a society. It's not just about money. It's not just about resource, though it is. But fundamentally, it has to be about what value do we give to care and what price do we put on that dignity.
STEM issue is, there's a clear STEM issue. I mean, Labour Market Survey 2013, 70% of women with STEM qualifications are not working in a STEM-related workplace. You know, three times as many boys as girls take up STEM qualifications, depending on roughly, in this country. Other countries, it's different. So, following on from what you're saying, there is a societal attitude to it. What the institution is trying to do, we are offering programmes to schools because we do understand that schools are resource constrained across a number of metrics. We offer sort of STEM activity programmes where we offer going into schools. We do it in Aberdeen. We do it across Scotland. You know, bridge building. Activities, you know, 1 hour activities, it ticks the curriculum for excellence, and offering that. But it does take financial support, which comes from within our industry, to try and encourage all pupils into STEM activity. But yeah, there is a clear target to introduce at primary school, primary 5, 6, 7, girls in particular. We take it to a girls' school in Aberdeen, for example, STEM activities, you know, bridge building. Is a classic case.
The way Dr. Macaskill was arguing just now, it's, you know, very early that the kids are picking up about who cares and who's nurturing and all that kind of thing. Do you think within your sector, engineering, it's actually a bit later on that youngsters are thinking, oh, engineering's for boys?
I think they make those decisions at a later date. I've been on these programmes myself. You do tend to see a difference between girls and boys who are undertaking these activities. The boys go forward, and the girls it sometimes are a revelation to them. And it's interesting to go into an all female environment, you get a completely different dynamic. Suddenly the girls all go forward, they all go forward together. There's almost a restriction amongst the class. This is just purely my personal opinion from having seen it, that girls will stand back and let the boys do it.
Like in a college class,
something
like that.
I'm talking about primary.
Oh, sorry, six, school, seven, sorry, sorry, sorry.
Primary,
right,
school,
yes,
level.
Right, right.
That actually starts to change when they get older. We have other programmes that we have targeting first and second year students. It's the sort of disaster relief scenario. But again, it's hands-on engineering activities. Then the girls suddenly have jumped. And it's almost as though the girls who have decided that they will be engineers, and it tends to be quite a small percentage, I'm sorry to say, are pushing themselves forward to do it and get their hands on what we're offering them. But I think, just my personal observation is, at primary school level, it's almost like an acceptance that boys will do this and the girls won't. But if you can get an all-girl class doing it, it's a completely different dynamic.
How do we tackle that then? I mean, do we change the teachers? Is it part of teacher training? Is it?
I think it is part teacher training. I think it's part. When you approach a school, and I've done it, and we have, you know, our engineering graduates and students do it, if you're lucky, you'll get a teacher who's engaged with STEM activities. It tends to be the engineering sciences department, for example. Sometimes it can be a geography teacher or something like that. If you have a teacher who's open and willing to it, the whole school will take it up. We've seen it. Unfortunately, when that teacher moves from that school, as I've seen it happen at an academy in Aberdeen, the school stopped doing it, but the school that she moved to took it up, and they took it up until she moved school from there to there. It's almost like there's tiny oases in a desert of people who are, of teachers who are willing to engage and take it on.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions from Richard Leonard.
Thanks, convener. I've got a very specific one for Val Dougan in connection with the Law Society Scotland submission, and then a more general one about procurement and outsourcing. You say there's a section in the submission, Val Dougan, contributory factors to litigation, and you list from A to L a whole number of reasons why you think there has been an awful lot of litigation around equal pay. Especially in local government and arising, as you see it, from the single status agreement. I actually thought that'd be in the interest of your members to have lots of litigation, but nonetheless, you seem to take a view of it. Under section K of your list, you point to what you describe as the failure of local authorities to outsource to genuine third parties pursuant to standard procurement processes, rather than to external arm's-length organisations, arm's-length external organisations, ALIOs, where the council retained an ownership or controlling stake or share. Now, am I right in thinking, though, that because these workers were outsourced to an ALIO, it then became possible for them to pursue equal pay claims because a court of session ruling deemed that the women working in ALIOs would be allowed to compare themselves with men working directly for the council, in that case Glasgow City Council, whereas had they been outsourced to genuine third parties, as you describe it, they certainly wouldn't have had any remedy in the law under the Equal Pay Act.
Yeah, I should say that obviously didn't write that submission. Somebody else did. I'm actually obviously aware of the issues about equal pay in the public sector, but really my role here today was more to talk about the legal profession and the gender pay gap within the legal profession. So I'm quite happy to take any kind of points away about the public sector and single status, but that's not really something that the society has a sort of firm view on. And I can obviously speak to the person who wrote that part of the report, because that wasn't me.
Okay, thank you. We've found from some of the evidence that we've been given that outsourcing appears to be something that drives the gender pay gap even wider than otherwise it might have been, because of not being a remedy through the Equal Pay Act to address it.
I think what you can definitely see is that the Equal Pay Act and going into the Equality Act has been a very ineffective means of trying to drive equal pay, and I don't think anybody is going to sort of disagree with that. The individual reactive legislation has not made a great deal of difference, and that one of the major problems around, as I see it, with gender pay is that people conflate it with equal pay, and the two are completely distinct terms. And actually, one of the reasons why people in the past have been reluctant to actually even understand what their gender pay gap has been is because of potential exposure to equal pay claims. And so I think if there is one thing that we can do in terms of this committee and the work that comes out is the distinction between equal pay and gender pay, and that people will be a lot more willing to actually tackle their gender pay, because gender pay is so much more than pay. It's about the distribution, as we've heard. It's about occupational segregation. It has an element of pay discrimination within it, but it's so much more than that. So if we can start to have a more informed debate about what actually equal pay is and what gender pay is, I actually think it's better for pushing forward gender pay, because people will stop being sort of worried about this kind of potential threat of equal pay and potential litigation. And I have to say that you know, equal pay as in the private sector within, you know, is few and far between. We obviously saw a lot within the public sector in relation to single status and then the sort of second wave of claims. But that's sort of finishing now. And we've only seen a little bit, really, in relation to the private sector coming out of the sort of supermarket cases and ASDA. So there is a little that's still sort of there, but things like tribunal fees have had a massive impact on litigation. So I'm not sure if I can talk about particularities of ALMOs, I'm afraid to say, but I can certainly sort of give a view on the distinction between gender pay and equal pay.
Could I just probe with this one supplementary, which sure. is, and I do appreciate the difference between gender pay, mm-hmm. The gender pay gap and equal pay, but do you think that there is therefore not really a problem of equal pay in the private sector, just because we've seen this mountain of cases in the public sector and very few in the private sector? Does that mean that the private sector's got it about right and the public sector's got it woefully wrong, or is it just that the torch hasn't been shined on the private sector sufficiently?
I don't think we know, is the position. And people within the private sector, there's no transparency in terms of pay scales, and so people do not know what their colleagues are earning. It's a completely different mindset. And I think when you speak to anybody that works within the public sector, they always find that quite strange, that because they always know in terms of gradings and scales, and the fact that you can work in a private sector organisation, you have absolutely no awareness of what your colleagues earn. And so, you know, there were previously, you had the ability to submit an equal pay questionnaire, you know, these aspects of the legislation, that's been pulled back, so you can't do that anymore. So there are difficulties around that. There's a real reticence, there's a real cultural reticence about asking about pay. And although the Equality Act changed the legislation to say that you're no longer able to sort of prohibit pay discussions, so the sort of removal of pay transparency, I think, you know, we just don't know what the issue is in the private sector. So possibly one of the things coming out of the gender pay gap reporting will be firms actually looking at what their pay gap is and actually drilling down to say, why do I have this gap and what does that mean? But I think they will really only start to understand that if they start to go beyond the statutory metrics and start to look at it at grade level, because I think it's only really once you start to drill down at grade level that you start to understand what the distribution of your workforce is. So, I mean, I think that's potentially one of the limitations of the regulation.
Paisey.
I think drilling down to grade level, I think, is absolutely key. What that does is it would highlight if there's any difference within an organisation. Within accountancy, I don't think you'd actually find that many differences within an organisation in the sense of, you know, for example, if you had a male and a female who both got a training contract with EY, for example, I'm absolutely sure that they would be paid the same rate. But one of the things that I found quite surprising in some research that I'd been involved in, which is reported in the submission that I've, the written submission that I've made, is that actually what you can find within accountancy at the newly qualified level, which is a very early level where you wouldn't really have expected much in the way of a gender pay gap, is that there is a gender pay gap roughly of the order of 11%, but that's not within individual firms. Within the firm, a male and a female will be getting the same. But what we found when we drilled down into that data was that people who were working for small and medium-sized employers were getting less than people who are being employed by big four accountancy practices. Now that, I think, we would expect. I think that is not unusual in itself, but then the reason for the gap is because more females were actually being employed by those small and medium-sized firms. So basically the issue was occurring not within an organisation, but across organisations. So if there's a tendency for females to get traineeships with small and medium-sized firms and slightly more of a percentage of males going to the big four firms, then that's going to exacerbate a gap simply because there's something at the recruitment stage that people are getting some jobs as opposed to other ones. Now, I have to say that was a very unusual finding. I was really surprised by that. I didn't expect it at all. But it's only when you are able to then compare one organisation with another that you actually start to see that coming out. And that's not something that's going to be terribly easy to do, I think, even with the new transparency that's going to be coming in.
Just to anticipating maybe the question about procurement, social care procurement obviously has its own statutory guidance, and that's a human rights-based set of principles, personalisation and involvement, engagement. I think what we've seen in social care is a direct impact by the inability to implement that statutory guidance, which has led to increased negative terms and conditions in the non-statutory sector. So one day, a local authority celebrates itself as the Scottish Living Wage employer, and 2 days later seeks to enter into a contract with a charity providing home care, which makes it impossible for that organisation to pay its workers the Scottish Living Wage. You know, as somebody who sits on the Fair Work Commission subgroup on social care, there is a profound issue there about the hypocrisy of publicly stating you're a Scottish Living Wage Fair Work employer and commissioning and procuring a third party, be it charitable or for profit, in a manner which prevents them from ensuring that they are able to diminish gender segregation and occupation segregation.
Right, well, thank you very much. I think we've run out of time, I'm afraid, but thank you to all of you for coming in today and for your contributions. And I'll suspend the meeting now and move into private session.